Hello, and welcome back to our next panel. As you might recognize, I just switched to English, and that's because we're getting even more international and now, and also travel through time and space. It's the 1920s now, just after the First World War, and Europe is on the edge of collapse, but is now trying to regain its faith. We follow the fates of extraordinary children, men and women, from nine different nations, and we just digged in to the eight-part series Clash of Futures 18, an international co-production by Lux Films from Leipzig and Le Film DC from Paris, in which some stories also follow up the actions of the series 14 Diaries of the Great War. We had a panel about that production 3 years ago. Here to tell you more and to discuss and conduct the talk, please welcome with a big applause Professor Peter Gottschalk.
I'm not only the only one. Hello, everybody.
No, you're not the only one.
Bon après-midi.
We're following you.
So, to do the follow-up, we will see now the clip, the first clip already about 14.
Je suis tout à toi.
Oh, Paul. J'aimerais tant te donner un avant-goût du paradis.
Baïonnette au canon!
Pas mourir. Pas mourir. Pas mourir. Je veux pas mourir. Je veux pas mourir.
Ça suffit! Ressaisissez-vous! Oh de Dieu!
Natürlich hätte ich mich gerne von Leutnant Waldecker küssen lassen.
I felt an appetite for danger.
Les soldats sont joyeux.
Je dois être snatch.
Hoffnung.
Pain. Malheur.
So, meine Herren! Dann wollen wir mal! En avant!
Is this in any way safe?
Well, let's find out!
Allez, Martin, rassure!
Baron!
Hello, everybody. 14, a series of 8 episodes, 8 hours, told the story of the First World War. I suppose Lars mentioned it already, called the Great War, First World War in English, the Great War. We call 14 now the first season. And 3 years ago, 214, same place here, nearly same time, we were talking about this production here on stage together with executive producer Gunnar Dedio. Now, today, we will talk about 18, Clash of Futures, the second season. And we will talk now for around about 75 minutes. We have wonderful guests this early afternoon. This is Dr. Regina Bouchehri. By the way, she is a teacher of this university. Here are two guys. She was teaching to the master class. And she was here 2 years ago when we had the Medienforum about Charlie Hebdo, what was shortly after the shooting in Paris. So Friday was the shooting in Paris, and we had 4 days later, we had the Medienforum about the panel about Charlie Hebdo. And Regina was reading at this time three literature texts, and one was Kant, Immanuel Kant. You remember?
Of course.
He had to write it in German. But he remembers very well. So we have wonderful guests. The second one is Jan Peter. Jan Peter is the showrunner of this series and of the series 18. He is the director. And we will talk about how to do this, how to direct suspense, and how to direct such a long a series. And the third one, last but not least, Dr. Jean-Michel Johnston. Jean-Michel is the only native speaker here, and he is not only an English native speaker, because his mom is French and his dad is British. So he is a native speaker in English and in French. And perhaps sometimes we will move from English to French, but however, you will follow. So Jean-Michel is coming from an old traditional university, the University of Oxford. And maybe after then some will talk to him how to go by Erasmus to Oxford University. You are invited to talk to him. So we will begin to talk about this production 18, and I will talk to Regina. Well, Regina, how do you handle this? It's 8 hours, and there's sometimes a beginning. There was the decision, it was decided, and how do you handle this to come into going, into marching, because it's very complicated. 8 hours, we will talk about after then how to direct it, but already producing, there is a beginning. And how did you handle this?
Well, actually, you're not doing an eight-hour series in an 8-hour working day, usually. It's always more than that, because it's indeed a huge production. Actually, I was not there when the first idea for Clash of Futures was born, because it was already during 14 or in the midst of the production of it. And I think the first subventions, film funds, were asked for money in 2012 or 2013.
2012.
So really a long, long time ago. And well, there is a first idea. Thanks to 14, there is a quite clear vision of what you want. There are already first partners on board, but then you have to find the money. You start with some first 50,000 or so from a financing partner, and then you try to get together the money. Now we are, for this production, we have something like 16 or 17 broadcasters on board. There are a lot of other TV broadcasters from all over Europe,
Tell some of you.
Well, our most important partners in Germany, it's SWR, who is the leading partner. It's WDR, NDR, and RBB, who all together form the ARD in Germany, and RT Germany as well. We have RT Strasbourg on board with you as a commissioning editor.
That's me.
We have RT France. We have, as a further co-production partner, the ORF from Austria, Czech television, and also TVP from Poland. And all the others are luckily only licensing partners, which means that they are not so much involved in the development and production process, but they just get the program after. Hmm.
So in Europe, we must say, more or less all countries all public stations are in, and
the
minority
missing,
is who is not in. Yeah,
they will come. So we have Sweden. Yeah. We have Russia now. Austria, France, Germany, Poland,
BBC.
Czech television, BBC in Britain, all the other Scandinavian countries, Finland, Norway, Denmark, and I don't know. I don't know they all of them by heart, but really,
so
it's half Europe.
Regina, you are the producer. Just to explain for our guests, what's the difference between, I mentioned Gunnar, the executive producer, you are the producer. What's the difference in this dans la terminologie?
The main difference is that Gunnar, as a producer and the owner of the company LuxFilm, is really the one who has the whole economic financial risk for the project. And me, I'm only an employee, so my risk is only this project. And I have to take care that this project will go into the right direction, that it will grow, and that at some point it will be finished, and that it will be good.
You have a sort of responsibility for the budget. What's the budget? Tell us about the budget. That's confidential.
Absolutely confidential.
It's confidential.
No, it's not.
This year.
It's around 9 million euros, actually. It's a bit growing from time to time.
Yes.
But we are always spending more and then finding more money. And I think this is my main responsibility. Because, of course, when you are involved in the creative process, all the money is spent during... Not all the money, but a big part of the money is spent during the creative process. And so you have the budget in your hands and you have to decide for what it's important to give it away, because you only can spend every euro once. And so you have to make the best out of it. Mm-hmm. And yeah, sometimes we are spending a bit too much, then we are trying to find more money. And this is the process how the budget is growing.
You know,
like always it is.
Yeah,
like this, huh?
Because you never have enough money for all you want to do.
The first rule of every film production is
never,
whatever
ever
money you have, it's never
not
enough.
Huh? Absolutely.
Are you nervous?
Nervous?
Not because you are here. No,
yeah,
no. concerning the money.
Not really, no.
Not really.
I think we will manage. It's sometimes not so easy because it's not obvious to convince all partners to join the project. Very often you have a first no and a second no, and then you have to go on, and this is where your job as a producer starts. The first yes is very, very seldom. You never have to give up.
Yeah, yeah. Regina, you see all here the academic title, and you see that Regina is a doctor. You wrote your doctor thesis about?
I wrote my doctor thesis about the translation of titles in literature, arts, theater and television, or film. Yeah. In a way, it was an excuse to just to have 3 years of financing, to dive deeper into a topic I was very interested in, which was mainly the translation of titles in cinema, or the non-translation, because this has a lot of intercultural aspects and communication aspects, but also to take just the chance to handle with all these different topics, because I studied intercultural communication and theater, and then during my studies I already discovered that there is a world that fascinates me even more than theater, which is film. And I somehow had to make the way from intercultural communication, from theater to film, and Dr. Thesis was the best chance. It was not so much about the degree, but it was a very important time for me.
And did you always want to become a producer?
No, as I said.
And how did it function? That you came as a you finalized your study. You had been a very young doctor already, and then how did you come to the television? It's now it's all it's media production.
The idea came before, because I just discovered that it's a wonderful world and that you can do a lot of things in film. I was not so sure about my position, what I wanted to do. But also because I did not know what jobs there are. Because you see a film, you see the actors, and you do not even see the cameraman. But besides that, you know that there's a director, but that there are millions of other jobs to be done before film is ready, I didn't know so much in detail because I never studied film production. And I only started to discover, and after I had finished my doctor's degree, I thought my biggest strength is foreign languages, mainly French, and so I just very classically wrote to a lot of film productions, mainly film productions who are doing co-productions, and just applied.
Okay.
And so I ended up at Lux. It's not really...
And Gunnar is very glad
America.
To have you. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So yeah. Far.
We
so
all are.
We will not do at the end frequently asked questions. We will do it always. So, is there before we move to Jan? Are there some not only frequently asked questions? Some questions you may talk in English, French, perhaps
German if you want.
German if you want and Spanish. Who is Spanish?
Well,
I think
long time ago.
Okay, almost okay.
Whatever you like. So, are there some questions or some Twitter or others? 21, 21, 22. Okay, not for the moment. So, but you must ask. Yeah? So, think about a question.
You're not here for fun.
So, and before we go now to Jan, I would like to show you the clip. Of 18, we produced in the beginning, or Lux produced in the beginning, Regina produced, and Jan and produced a clip. And you may see it if you want to see it. You go on the homepage of Lux Film, and there you have it. And we look at now. So I apologize, but I suppose you have to
get up.
To
again.
Get up otherwise, the subtitles are not cannot be seen. So, Jan, 18, once more, 8 hours, 8 episodes. Would you be so kind and tell us in, let me say, 4 main sentences, the plot of 18?
Good luck.
Yes, in 4 sentences. There is 1918. There
you may do semicolon sentences.
Yes. There is 1918. There ends the biggest war of mankind until then, because no one knows the future. And everyone is swearing to each other and promising each other never a war again. It is 10 million dead, it's devastated the old Europe, it devastated all the liberties the people had before already. And 20 years later, 21 years later, the same people who promised this jump into the next even more devastating, even more horrible war that even more changed the world forever. How is that possible? And it is really not the aim in 1918 to go to another war in 20 years. It's really the aim of millions and millions and millions never to do this again. And how is it possible? How did this happen? And behind this catastrophe or this disaster to create the new 30 years war as we know from today, is the questions of new ideas, new ideologies. This is clash of futures, different ideas of futures. Communism starts to become a very strong ideology in the end of World War I. Nationalism, national socialism, fascism, capitalism. Yeah, we have the golden 20s. So all these ideas, and there are many, many small ideas inside this, like vegetarianism or nude culture or art or dancing or drugs and heroin and cocaine and everything coming there. And all these new ideas create, in a way, our world today also. And to speak about these ideas and how they shape the world and how this catastrophe of the Second World War starts to become a reality, even though no one wants it, this is the storyline. And this is told again about 12 young people, mostly young people, very young, like 18, 19, 20, in 1918, and their way inside these 21 years.
There are some figures in 14, there are some figures in 18, mm-hmm. which will continue. How did you decide this?
There are 2 characters from 14, from the first season. when we developed 14, I can speak a little bit about this later, we did not know that it was the first season. We just wanted to create something, and then it was successful and was sold in the world. So we took the chance to create a second season. And well, there is two characters. There is one English officer. We have seen him shortly here in this explosion in the trenches. He is with him, with the soldier, we ending the First World War in the first episode of the second season. And there's this Russian Cossack girl you have seen in the trailer of 14 and in the teaser of 18, who is not
Natalia Witmer.
Natalia Witmer, who lives in Berlin. She was born in Omsk, in Siberia, very, very good and energetic young Russian-German actress. And they too continue, and then there are 10 new characters, completely new characters.
I will ask you a question about the series, but as we talked about now about Natalia, Russian, but living in Berlin, why did you always book actors which are really native speaking in this region where they are coming from in their as figure? So why did you do this?
It is one of the main core elements of this idea, Clash of Futures, to say we can be only true to our own ideas and to come closer to something like not reality, because we don't create reality. Huh? Not even the archive material creates reality, is a big misunderstanding. But maybe truth, which is more interesting than reality, because the truth is always one step deeper behind the reality. Behind the things we see lays different layers of truth. So, and one of these things we wanted to, from the beginning we wanted to do, this was a very hard fight with the TV stations, and Peter was really very supportive from Arte Strasbourg to help us. No, it's really a very big step. Very, very big step to have in German television to have something in original languages. Because everyone in German, many people in German television, many responsible people in German television think our audience will not understand. Our audience is too stupid. But if you make only stupid things for 20 years, you have only a stupid audience after that. So we said from the beginning, we want the real people there, the characters from the countries. The Russians are not German actors or French actors. The Italians are Italian actors. So it's a kind of truce. The language always gives also a kind of aesthetic pattern. It's not only that they speak Italian and people who understand Italian feel some words, but it's more than that. You feel when you hear Italian, when they move, when they touch each other, that you are in Italy. Like the Russians speak other, the language has already another kind of fabric, another kind of emotion in it. So it becomes really something to show the story of Europe in this first and second season. And to be honest with European story, it has to be different European countries. And that means Russia as well as Britain. Maybe not part of European Union, but part of European history.
Yeah. And it's huge fun casting in like 9 or 10 different countries.
Very complicated too, but also fun. Sometimes yes. It's fun, sometimes it's complicated, yes. And to come back to Regina, because we say what is the work, is I can say from my perspective, because Regina came as an intern to Lux in 2013 when we were in the post-production of 14, and it was a very, very stressful post-production. It is coming and surviving. This is That's the secret. It is really, really very hard, and they throw a lot of balls at you, and you have to kind of handle them, not to catch all of them, but to handle, to stay the most important balls in the air. And Regina has the big ability to survive, and this is the biggest ability for any producer. If you see in the end how many TV stations, it's not only fun or nice or we get money from them, it's like 40 or 50 people who have all different demands. All of them have different demands.
Worries, wishes. Yes.
And in different languages. And very important for the Finnish history is this. And very important for the Polish history is this. And Regina has to manage all of them to be content. But on the same level,
never to betray our...
Our vision.
Our vision. Yes. Because it will not make anybody happy if we do a bad film, bad quality, without any vision, but all the wishes of everybody are included. This doesn't help. But luckily, I have a brilliant showrunner who is able to understand what they really want. No, and this makes it much easier, because if not, you're really lost.
Jan, may I add one more question about series? Because we are talking about series. Series production is modern. Series looking, watching is something modern. And when I do not remember something 8-9 years ago, Breaking Bad was created. The first season was something like, okay, at the end, he will die. He has a cancer and he will die. Finally, he survived not only as a teacher, but he survived for 5-6 seasons. I even do not remember how many seasons. So it was the same when 14 was not the first season, it was a series. And then it became the first season. Mm-hmm. And so what's unique with this sort of format? And why is it a new format? Why is it something what is really unique and is now first season, second season, maybe there will be a third season?
Yes. What we wanted to do with this, and we started in 14, it was not clear from the beginning. It was a very, very long and strange way, in a way. We started to develop 14 in 2010, 2011. Already there in America, in the United States, the series was a big thing. But in Germany, no one, in the TV stations, no one really thought about it. And it started out as a real classical documentary, 8-part documentary. So we have one part about propaganda in the Great War, one part about women, and to put in some emotions, we put in some drama scenes, which are not really drama scenes because they don't develop from themselves, but they are used usually in docudrama, as you know, like a light switch. We have a thesis or a kind of idea of a narration, like a teacher, and then we have to show, click, emotion, that someone is crying or freezing or whatever. So it's a little bit, yes, simplistic, but you know what I mean. And this was the main idea. And we started to write, or some authors started to write the scripts, and it was very boring. After 1 year, we all felt it's very, very boring. And we don't know why. And you have usually 3 ways to deal with a boring script when you already worked 1 year. You can go on working on the boring script to try to make small improvements and to warn down the commissioning editors who get used to it after 4 or 5 years. They have not enough energy anymore, and they accept the mediocre scripts. You can quit, it's the second possibility, and you go to the countryside and become a farmer, which is always the dream of every media people, but you never do that. Huh? You always dream about it, but you never do it. Or the third possibility, you throw away everything. And it sounds easy, but after 1 year, it's not so easy. And you start anew. And this was, in a way, the biggest idea was, how do we tell history? How do we ourselves feel history happen? We don't know what happens tomorrow. There is no teacher telling us, ah, yes, it is clear that the government will be this and this and this and so on. We don't know it. We don't know. It's like in a diary. You don't know what happens tomorrow. A diary is always a kind of trying to find your way through the jungle. And this was the idea, to throw away our theories and to go back and to say, we tell history as it really happens, as uncertainty for everyone. We reduce the number of protagonists, of characters, to 14 or to 10. We take their diaries, it's real characters, and we tell every day, and they don't know what happens. They don't know the future. And there is no narration that tells us what happens in the future. And this was, from this moment on, we thought, the next step is to link the characters, to have not one episode about propaganda, one episode about women, but to have 8 episodes about human beings in the course of the war. And then we started to have the idea of a series of cliffhangers, of all these technical things. And it was very new and very bizarre for the TV stations 5-6 years ago. Now, in the second season, we did not have to convince anyone about this anymore. There were other problems, but not this one.
I would now, we will talk about, after then, with Jean-Michel, once more about history and about transnational storytelling, history storytelling and all this. I would add a small chapter, about suspense. Mm-hmm. Because you are really a master of suspense storytelling. And suspense is really hard work, we know it. Yes. And just to mention, Jan is not only doing documentaries, fiction, docudramas, and all this sort of series. He is since more or less 20 years doing television. And some years ago, it was nearly parallel to 14 and 18, he did something what is really very, very extraordinary about a subject where everybody meant all is said. It was the about Pope John Paul II, and when in 81, the 13th of May in 1981, Ali Aksha wanted to kill John Paul II. Everybody, historians, meant it's told. There is nothing new. We know there are secret services. And Jan told in two episodes production something where everybody said, yes, it's something new. I never heard. And now just to begin this part, we look to the trailer. We have a small trailer about this production.
And we jump up.
Yeah, of course.
So once more, the 13th of May, 81, Mehmet Ali Aksha tried to kill John Paul II. How did you have the idea to tell once more this story? And second question, what was the new idea you told in this production?
The idea came more or less in a talk with different friends. I worked for many productions in Rome during the last 15 years, which was a very big luck for me because I love Rome very much. And we made a lot of docudrama and docudrama series about the history of the Vatican's and the Inquisition and witches and mistresses of the Pope and so on and so on. And some friends told me to say, but do you know that all the secret services are still very active in the Vatican's and that the Vatican is in a way considered to be the biggest secret service in the world because they have so many secret service agents, because every priest in every country, in every little village is in a way a secret service agent because he writes reports to the central station, to Rome, about all the things around. And so we thought, oh, I never heard that. And then we went to TV station and we wanted to have a kind of main point to tell the story of the Vatican in the Cold War around one event, and it was the event of the assassination attempt on John Paul II. But around that, before and after, we go into the secret world and the layers of secret agencies and secret services in the Vatican, and like always like this, we have layers of lies behind layers of lies behind layers of lies. And in 14 and 18, we use documentary elements to tell a fictionalized story. And in Pontifex, it was the opposite. I said, we have only a documentary without any fiction elements, but we use the dramaturgy, the dramaturgic tools of fiction. We tell a documentary like fiction, like a thriller, not with a narration, not again, not with the knowledge of a master or something, but we tell the interviews and we use interview partners like actors. They are real interview partners. They are telling things they really think it's true, but they lie also. And we go inside their lives and try to use them like fiction characters. And so we build the dramaturgy of a fiction film with only documentary elements. And this was the new thing that worked quite well.
How did you get these guys who, well, it's 81, most of the students here even were not born at this time. So how
also did the two doctors here are not only the students.
How did you get these people, and now they tell something they didn't tell during the last 30 years?
There was especially one guy, the Polish guy, who said I was called the mole.
He was the Pope's assistant.
Yes, he was one of a very, very close assistants of Pope John Paul II, a Jesuit, but he was a Secret Service agent from the beginning. He was even a Secret Service agent before he became a Jesuit. He was sent by the Polish Secret Service to become a Jesuit, and he's very clever, and he never spoke about it. So he was really a new character, and we met him with a lot of problems and dates he did not turn on in Warsaw in a bar, and he brought his revolver with him. He told, in front of, before the interview, he showed me his gun, and he said, "Yes, I'm so he lives in Russia because in Poland everyone wants to kill me." And it's a very bizarre guy, and you always never know how much is true or not. It's like with all these people, and we had national security advisors of Ronald Reagan and things like that. But you try, like always, like Regina said, like we said, you go on, you get a no. You get a second no, you get a third no. After the third no, your work starts. If you get a yes in the first one, it's no work at all. The people who start working after the third no, this is the people who stay in the business. Okay. So this is you can say.
Yeah, okay. And now, because we must come back to 18, now, Jan, tell us your secret. You are really a master of suspense. How to create suspense here and how to create suspense in general. Give us our secret. Give us your secret. How to
Don't.
Create suspense. it's also confidential.
No, I don't think it's something like there is one secret ingredient and you can... It's the same thing, like with emotion. You can't push only one switch, but you have... The first thing is you have to love and to take all... You love all your characters, either in documentary or in fiction, and to take them seriously. And you always have to ask yourself, what is the main question behind every scene? A big problem in many productions, also in mine, but also in German production, is very often that you mingle different things, that you mix different things. The opinion of the writer, the opinion of the director, different aims of the main characters. But this gives a kind of mediocre feeling. You don't hurt anyone, but you don't feel. And you have to be strict and to decide for one perspective, for one idea, for one question in every scene. And this sounds very simple, but it's very complicated to reduce the questions in the end to one real question. It's what I said about reality and truth. What is the real motivation behind a real character, behind a fictional character, and what leads to the next step into his or her life? And if you identify this, you have a kind of tool that you can use quite easily. But you have to be strict with yourself. You don't have to be fooled. There are many interesting things and colorful things people live through, but they are not the real question. The real question is very often, like in a dream. You dream about something, but the message in your dream is not the things you dream about. It's something under this. And you have always to identify the thing that is under a movement, an action, a kiss, a shoot, whatever. And if you do that, it's a little bit like historians do. You want to try to find the underlying motives in someone. And if you try to identify and you concentrate only on this one, you have a good scene.
Mm-hmm. I would like to ask you also something very practical because it's interesting for our audience. Now you are, there is the montage of mm-hmm. 8 episodes. Mm-hmm. And just to announce you, we will during this panel we will see a short clip of which episode?
The beginning of episode 2.
2. Yeah, it's still something never seen. Nobody saw it, even. So, and it's really just for here and not for YouTube, please. So, and now you are always. With several cutters, mm-hmm. several people, you are doing this hard work. And how many times do you need to create one episode, to create the first, in French you call it Cernus, that's a beer.
Yes, Cernus. Yeah?
How many times do you need to have the first idea and then you go on and it's fine-tuning to create now suspense, to create a rhythm and all this? How much time do you need? How is this work? Tell us a little bit about this.
It's always, it's like with the money. It always takes more time than it was supposed to do. The first rule is your script, even though everyone loved your script and you loved it very much, it never works in editing anymore because it always has too much words. It always has things that you can't see in picture because it's written words. But the moment you take the words away, the things are living or not. It's always, you have to recreate many, many things, especially in a format that mixes archive and fiction in this very intense way. And then you go on, and we have to finish until the spring of 2018, and we will finish until the spring of 2018. But like always, you start with reasonable 8 or 10 hours a day, and you end with 16, 18 hours a day, because in the end, the time is always
running out,
like the money, and you have to finish. No, but it's like this. You have to go on, and you have to find your way. And even though we created 14, even though we thought we knew the DNA of things, no, we have to forget everything, and we have to recreate
start new.
Everything anew. And it's another time. You don't have the background of the war that makes it very easy to jump, you know, from one character to one character, from Russia to France, because it's always the war. Now, in 21 years, you don't have the same history anymore. Moscow in 1923 is a very different place from Berlin or Paris in 1923, which is a very different place from London in 1935. So it's very, very different to mix the characters, to tell a story that has no background of war, which has a story that has more or less only a timeline in common. Because someone who lives in Stalinist Moscow in 1936 has almost nothing in common with someone who lives in Berlin in 1936. And this, and to still find links between the characters, it's a real new work and very, very interesting, but a big challenge. But we have to finish until next spring.
And we will.
We will
I'm
finish
sure
until
about
next
it.
Spring. This is the next thing you have to know when you work, especially in television. It's a little bit different in cinema. You have to keep the dates in the end. Genius or not, if you don't keep the dates, you are out. It's very simple like this. In television, it's very strict. Yeah. So in the end, you have to keep the dates, and we will keep the dates.
Frequently asked questions to showrunner and director Jan Peter. Please. Yes, please. Micro for the colleague.
We saw the trailer of 18, and we saw scenes, entertaining scenes. We saw, let's call it action scenes. We saw, let's call it sex scenes. And could we agree that you use this entertainment surface to convey some, let's say, political messages below? There are people in Germany, they call Arte, they call the ARD the government television. And maybe they suppose that you want to convey messages, that you want to use the entertainment as like a Trojan horse to give some lessons in history. Could that be?
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Rush.
I think it was John Ford, very famous American director in the 50s, who said, who was asked about the messages he wanted to deliver. He says, when I want to deliver a message, I go to Western Union. That means I send a postcard or a telegram. A director who takes his or her job seriously, I think, can never deliver a message. It's just artistically not possible, whether the government wants it or not. I don't care. So I never met someone from the government anyway, but maybe, I don't know, maybe it's secret government agents, but you can never know. But but for me, artistically, the message is a question I don't ask myself at all. Because the moment you deliver a message, you are lost, because people feel that you want to deliver a message, and it's very boring. Your parents tell you, don't do that, don't do that. You do exactly the opposite. So it's very against the inner core of telling an interesting story to deliver a message. And to use entertainment elements like sex or war or whatever, I can only hope your life is entertaining in a way, because sex and love, and it's part of all our lives. It's not entertainment, it's our life. We tell the life of people. That means love and sex and hate and desire and fear and ideology and hate. All these things are, of course, shown because this is what our life consists of. And this is what the life of our characters consists of. But for me, as I say, it's not interesting to deliver a message. I do not even want to deliver the message Nazis are bad or communists, because I don't, if the characters don't show their own ways, I failed as a director. This is very simple. So I take Rudolf Höss, who become the commander of Auschwitz and who can really easily destroy, I take him seriously as everyone else, because he's an 18-year-old soldier in 1918 who wants to fight for Germany, who does not understand the defeat in the First World War, and who wants to go away like many, many, many million young men or women wanted to go to save Germany. And I don't betray this character in the moment that I say from the moment, oh, he's a bad guy and we know he's becoming bad. No, I watch him on this way, whatever turn he takes. And he takes the turns he takes. It's not my life. I only want to come close to a character and to take away the distance we feel very often to historic films. Ah, it's all dead people. Ah, they are all old. Ah, we are so much more clever today. No, we are not. We are not more clever, and they are as young as you are. That's all. That's all. That's all what I want to do.
Okay. By the way, it's a very important question as one international co-production, because Germany is Germany, and but already if you go to France, and especially there is the, as it is also together with Polish people,
oh, yes.
Polish public station, and for example, last time when we were together, the Polish delegation came for the first time, and we have these discussions, but as a co-production, we must be free, and but we have to communicate. This is the job of Regina, yeah, to communicate. So it was a thanks for this question. One more, please. Whoever likes, in French, perhaps. En français, si vous voulez.
There is one.
A microphone, please. What language? English?
Yeah, English.
Great, great. Thank you.
I have a few
questions. Would you give us your name, please? Would you be so kind and give us your name, please?
I'm Magdalena Schippmann. Hi.
Thank you.
I have a few questions, but maybe we can do later. So my question I want to ask is to the writing process. So in which language do you write, and how does it work with the translation?
Uh-huh.
Ah, it's
good questions.
It's very, very important.
Perhaps Regina, and after then Jan. Okay.
If you want.
Absolutely.
Okay. So indeed, we worked with different co-authors. Jan was the main author, but we worked with a French co-author and sometimes also with a Swedish co-author, Camilla Algren, and someone from Luxembourg, Jean-Louis Schlesser. And every one of them needed to write in their mother, in their native language.
This was a decision we took.
Yeah. We had a lot of discussions in English, rather bad English most of the time, but writing was always done in the native language, because I think you always lose a lot of the meaning, a lot of your freedom when you try to write in another language. And therefore, it was a lot of translations back and forth from French to German, from German to French, from German to Swedish, from Swedish to German. Because in the end, everything ended up, all the scenes that the other co-authors wrote ended up in Jan's hand, who made something out of it, and who, in the end, created the whole episodes. Because we split by scenes and not by episodes. Yeah.
And we thought about writing in English. It's a very big question also in Germany right now, when everyone creating a writer's room, and now we invented in a way the series in Germany after 15 years. So a lot of colleagues write in English, and I in a way I admire to do that. But our decision was from the beginning, since we have all the original languages anyway, So Hans Beimler and Rudolf has to speak in German, and Mé Picré has to speak in French. It's better to share the things with the characters, to split it and to lead together later. But it's possible also to write in English, of course, but I think it was the right decision for this project. Not for every project, for this project is all right. And it's one big role of Jean-Michel, who is not only here as a historian from Oxford, but is a very good friend and supporter of all the project as well, because Jean-Michel was also involved in 14 and 18, and many, many jobs, as always, he survived also. And a very important job, he translated, and not only translated, he created the English scripts, which is the main scripts, because on the shooting, in an international crew from 10 different countries, you work with the English script. And Jean-Michel did create the English scripts, and it's only one thing that is very important to know. We are Germans writing about British characters, which is for the BBC really bizarre. It's horrible. It's the most horrible thing you can imagine. But that they felt English or Scottish in the end, it's really thanks to Jean-Michel, who recreated things I wrote in German, but an English man or English woman would never say or think, and recreated the Englishness. And so in the end, it was really that the BBC, they were very, very, very afraid about the dialogues, the language, our idea of England. They had nothing to criticize about this, because they said, yeah, it feels English. And this is more than translation, it's recreating the things. And so we learn to know each other, and so Jean-Michel is linked to the projects.
I was going to say, it was, for me too, a learning process, because I'd never really translated dialogues before, and it took a while to get to know also the way that Jan writes, to understand the kind of feelings that are supposed to come across, things that would otherwise get lost in translation if you're being too literal.
Absolutely.
Okay for you?
But the shooting scripts are in English in the end.
With the original dialogues in the middle of it.
Because after when production is finished, there's always the discussion, will we do dubbing, total dubbing? And then you destroy what Jan explained. If you are totally dubbing,
yes,
you do not need a South Australian actor to do the to play the protagonist who is coming from South Australia. It may be somebody of Lithuania or wherever. So this is a very, very important discussion, and we did not finish up to now. So you will see how the discussion will be finished. So as Jean-Michel already now, I may introduce you once more. Jean-Michel discovered yesterday a connection between his doctor thesis and Mittweida.
Yes.
What was it, Jean-Michel?
Well, Mittweida's, well, it's founded in 1867, which is the same year that Werner Siemens, who is very famous for creating a telegraph, later telephone and communications company, obviously still well known today. 1867 was the year not only that Mittweida was founded, but that he presented his idea for a dynamo to the Prussian Academy of Sciences, which in a sense kind of inaugurated a new media age, a new electrical age. And I mean, thanks to Peter, we went through the archives of Mittweida's university, and there's a lot of interesting material there, where you can see the development of electronic communications devices through the ages, from the telegraph to the telephone, and all sorts of computers out of from the GDR and more recently.
So, once more to introduce you, Jean-Michel finished his doctor's thesis this summer. So you may give your congratulations. Still, it's some 3-4 months ago. And he is now working at the Faculty of Literature.
Yeah.
At the Faculty of Literature at the University of Oxford, a very traditional in university with a long, long, long tradition. And he's teaching there, and he is writing, and he is an author. He's, if you do his name in He is publishing his articles, so I invite you to read his articles and what he was writing. And Jean-Michel, he prepared us, and he will talk to us about, as we are here, what we are talking about is the container. A theory is a container, and the stuff which is going into the container, this is history, and about history and storytelling, and now it's your turn, Jean-Michel.
Thank you. Yes, well, I mean, my involvement with the project was very much in parallel with my academic studies, which focused on the history of communication and technology in Europe. So for me, it was very interesting to see, on the one hand, how I was looking at media, the role of media in history, but at the same time, thinking about how the role that history plays in the media. The project I'm working on now is called Disease of Modern Life. It's looking at how people reacted to what we consider the stresses of modernity, a lot of which are linked to new media in the same way in the 19th century as people do today in the 20th century. But a lot of what I was reflecting on when I was lucky enough to help out with these projects was, what exactly is it that media can do that traditional history writing can't? Is it just a question of essentially taking the narratives that we have about periods that we know very well about and just making them slightly more entertaining and having nice pictures and essentially just broadcasting what other people could read in history books? Or is there something that media can channel which traditional history can't? Obviously, my opinion is the latter. It's particularly useful when you're dealing with a period as complex as, well, the First World War, but also the interwar years, which are dealt with in this series, because it's a period during which people are constantly looking forward, trying to create new futures, but they're always haunted by their past, by the First World War, but also the kind of habits and prejudices that they had before then. So as Jan was saying, historians are in a way divided between whether we should consider these 20 years a period of reconstruction during which Europe had an opportunity to start something new and it broke down in 1939, or should we think of the whole period 1914 to 45 as a massive 30 years war during which Europe was trying but often failing to come together. And so these tensions are things that can be dealt with in ways through a TV show that you can't in a book. For instance, thinking about 1918 when the series begins, in many ways it is a rupture, as you were saying. You have 15 million civilian and military deaths in the First World War. You have four empires collapse. Around a dozen new states are created, and it is an opportunity to start something new. There's an attempt to create democracies in the kind of out of the remains of what was the Austrian Empire. And of course, then in the 20s and 30s, socialism and fascism emerge as these new visions for how to organize society and government. And these are the futures that then clash over 20 years. But at the same time, there's a lot of the old world that remains in the 1920s. So in some ways, 1918 is not such a rupture. To take an example, you know, just a year after the end of the First World War, the attempt of socialism to break through in Russia is resisted by conservative forces, backed by Western quasi-democratic or supposedly democratic forces, and you have a civil war which lasts for another 2 years, which kills another 7 million people. There are other examples. The British are so concerned that the empire is going to collapse after the end of the First World War that you have violence and repression in India and in Ireland, where there are attempts in the wars of independence there. And this kind of tension between backwards and forwards continues through the 20s, because you have these ideas that people are pushing, but ideas, or ideologies are carried by people, and people have memories, people have habits, people have prejudices. So in the 20s, as Jan was saying, there's this period of economic recovery, the roaring 20s or the golden 20s, depending on what country you're from and what you want to call it. People were, you know, the economies of Europe had recovered. People were listening to jazz, dancing the Charleston. Berlin was this kind of symbol of the frivolities that people could enjoy. But at the same time, there were signs that things weren't going as well as people thought. There's this quote, which I think you use at some point, from Gustav Stresemann, who was saying that Germany was dancing on a volcano, and you could say that the whole of Europe was dancing on a volcano, ignoring the tensions beneath. Whilst in the south of Europe, a lot of conservative or authoritarian governments were taking over. These visions of democracy were starting to crumble. In the 20s, you have Mussolini taking power in Italy, and he promotes a vision of the future, but in many ways is supported by old elites who are actually worried about revolutionary change. And then it took the sort of crisis of 1929 with the Wall Street financial crash for these tensions to emerge everywhere, including in the supposedly more stable democracies. And so during the 30s, you have this kind of breakdown of democracy. The most famous example is always, of course, the appointment of Hitler in 1933 as Chancellor of a Germany which had actually remained relatively democratic. But historians now recognize that although this is an extreme and terrible example of how that could happen, this wasn't some kind of aberration. No. You had fascism throughout Europe. I mean, Britain had its British Union of Fascists led by Oswald Mosley. You had the L'Action Française and Le Faisceau in France. This really was an international movement, which sort of came to a head during the Spanish Civil War, when forces from different countries fought on either side of a conflict pitting sort of nationalist, authoritarian movement led by Franco and a left-wing republic. And in a sense, by the time you get to 1938-39, the cracks in the democracies were clear. Either regimes had collapsed, or countries like France and Britain were riddled with so many collapsing coalitions or constant changes in government that clearly the problem was more widespread than just individual nations adopting particular ideologies.
Jean-Michel, you mentioned it in 38, 39, all collapsed. So there had been dozens of new countries, and after more or less 18, 19 years, these 20 or 30 countries, the Baltics and all this, they collapsed, they were no more there. Why did all this collapse in 38? Was it just the Second World War? What was it? Why collapsed Europe and the world?
Well, as I said, I think it's this combination of tensions which were always there, but which people either didn't want to acknowledge or kind of brushed aside. To take examples like anti-Semitism, which again is associated almost in traditional historiography, almost exclusively with Germany in the 1930s, but anti-Semitism existed throughout Europe and since before the First World War. And these were tensions which were given a voice in the 30s and which exploded in particular ways. It wasn't something new in 38, 39, but it was that democracies had lost the capacity to structure themselves.
Some people now, I know historians, they don't like to go to the present. But some people now mention Weimar, and especially since Jamaica collapsed, that there will be a situation which was similar in Weimar. Do you agree? And what happens? And tell us some of your ideas about this. Is there a parallel between nowadays in Europe. It's not only in Germany. I'm living in France, you know, Le Pen was really nearby, and your parents live in Paris. Le Pen was anti-Portas, Marine Le Pen.
And we have more
than more than the father. And now you are living in Great Britain. There are also some things, by the way, collapsed. Some ideas. So tell us what is your idea as an historian?
Well, I don't want to make a political statement. I think people can draw the parallels that are there. There are clear similarities, but history doesn't repeat itself in exactly the same way. And I think, as Jan was saying earlier about transmitting messages, it's not about rereading history to say this is clearly what's happening. It's simply about rereading history in a way that makes sense today, that people can actually relate to. As I was saying, I think creating a narrative which takes into account the complexities of history is something which traditional history often struggles with, because you're confined to the structure of the book. You either have to think in thematic chapters or linear chronological chapters, whereas, although it's complicated, as Jan was saying, what you can do in a show, in a TV series or drama series, is to cut up the narrative with experiences, mix the experiences of different individuals and not simply have a new narrative. If people are then able to read into it and think differently about the world around them, then so much the better.
The big mistake I think you could do is always to use history as a kind of mot d'emploi, manual. It's like this, it was in 1935 or in Weimar 1929, and now it happens the same. It's only a mirror. You can only watch yourself. But if you can do that, that's already a lot. But you can never use history as a kind of Gebrauchsanweisung. This happens after this happens after this happens. The only thing that is sure is nothing is written until it's really happened. Yeah? It is not automatic, for instance, Hitler. To appoint Hitler 1 year later, it already could change everything. So it's never too late until it's really too late. You can fight for your ideas, whatever your ideas were, until the very end, because it's never on tracks.
And Regina? Things not just happen. It's always about decisions. And I think this is something we are telling with our story. It's about personal decisions. It's about your decision, my decision, very small steps that bring together, that lead to a big catastrophe in the end, maybe, or maybe not. But it's the decision of every single person that makes history in the end.
Just there's one question or one statement about Twitter, please.
Yes. So do you say your films have no sense and are only entertainment? Because for me, it's to deliver a message, the sense of every movie. Isn't there no reason to show people something when there's no goal for you? What do you want to deliver?
Somebody wants to...
Yes, I understand. The question is... My message was the question, or the government's message, or the message of people behind the scenes or whatever. I think a good film has a kind of meaning, maybe not a message, for every one woman or man who watches it. And for me, the thing is to open the doors for this kind of moments of insight, and it can be very different for everyone. But I don't want to overwrite, and it's really, as an artist, it's your fundamental duty not to put in a way your conscious message. Of course, I put in all my personality, and alone that we choose the people we choose, alone that we choose the camera angles we choose, it's my eyes to see the world, but not consciously put or override everything with a message. No, for me, a film opens doors into emotions. This is why you cry on love movies, if they are good, maybe even if they are not good. They open doors on insights. And I had in my life some moments where I came out of cinema, where I watched the film, and I really said, yes, I have to change my life, and now I understand something. But I'm sure it's not because the director wants me to have this feeling, but because the director is good enough and true enough to him or herself to open the doors to tell something that comes to the truth. And this is the thing. That's my opinion about my work. Everyone is open to have another opinion, but this is my opinion.
Just watch the series.
My last, Regina, my last question is, 18 is not only for the screen, yeah, and after then for, I don't know, for Netflix, 14 was on Netflix, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, or is still on Netflix?
Netflix, yes, yeah? Only. Yeah.
So, for 18, Clash of Futures is just in the middle, let me say, in the center, a little bit arrogant, but in the middle of a big production, of big productions around. And just tell us a little bit, because this is really very extraordinary, and I have no idea who organized this in this way already in the history of television. So tell us a little bit about
it. I think you're right. It's quite exceptional. Maybe just doing a television series is too boring for us. I don't know. It would be a lot of work, but we are doing more than that. We are. But it's not only us. We have a lot of partners. Clash of Futures is a huge cooperation project with 8 museums all over Europe. The leading museum partner is the Museum for Military History in Dresden, who already organized a very successful exhibition for...
Who had been there already?
14 Menschen, okay. Clique, it was called,
all
I don't know.
All others are invited to go there. it's one of the best museums.
It's not so far
it's
away from here.
It's not a military museum, it's a peace museum. So go there. And now, Regina.
And yeah, we had this the exhibition with them for 14, and then said, okay, let's do it again for 18, because it was such a huge success for Clash of Futures, rather. And they joined a lot of other museums because they have partnerships with other museums all over Europe. There will be a museum in France in Péronne, the Historial de la Grande Guerre, the Royal Museum of Fine Arts in Brussels, the Tate Britain will be part of it, the Mozak in Krakow, the Docs in Prague, which is a museum for modern history, and they all take the topic of Clash of Futures. Not always cover the same period of time, but they all have the same topic, the same title, and they have a different prospect of these things. Very interesting, and I think if you have other opportunities than only Dresden to go there, there will be a whole program starting in summer 2018, and going until 2020. Castel Tirolo in Italy, so 8 museums. There will also be, and I think this is for the first time in the history of television and theater, a theater piece based on the scripts of the series and of the autobiographies, memoirs, and diaries that are the basis of our TV series.
Where is it?
Staged in the Landestheater Salzburg in Austria, and it will be premiered in February 2018 already. I'm very much looking forward to it, very curious to know what they did out of it. There will be a school version also, and there will be a radio feature that will be broadcasted on SWR and WDR just before the broadcasting of the series. And by the way, the series will be broadcasted in September next year on RT, RD, and the third programs as well. Well, that's
we
the commercial
did,
part
did,
of it.
Did we mention the book?
DVDs, umbrellas.
Absolutely.
Did we mention the book already?
No, there's a book published by our historic advisor, Daniel Schönflug, in the Fischer Verlag. It's already out now. And there will be a social media project, which we are still working on, which will start early next year, to bring all these different elements together and to show how you can, from different sides of art, television, a film, exhibition, however, look on this topic and translate it, and what you can also take of it for today, for our lives, for our future. Because it's not so much about our past that we want to talk then about our future.
So, okay, then let's look to the clip. So, thanks a lot for this afternoon. Thank you, Regina. Pleasure. Thank you, Jan. Thank you, Jean-Michel, for coming. He came from Oxford. Tomorrow back to Oxford. And thanks, Jan, not going to the Baltic Sea to come to Mittweida. This is Mittweida, no Ilmenau.
I know. Yeah. I know now.
And thank you, Regina, for coming again to Mittweida. Thanks a lot.
Pleasure.
Thanks to Luisa and all the people in backstage. Where is Luisa? Somewhere. She prepared it and she forced me always to bring some ideas about the panel. So thanks a lot. She is not here. She is shy. She is not coming. Thanks a lot for coming. Thank you all. And enjoy. I do not know. Is there another panel after that? Here? Yeah? Okay. Enjoy the next panels and enjoy how whatever you are doing, media management, media engineering. I suppose that's, you didn't know, there is a sort of lounge to come together.
The meet and greet.
Yeah. It's the first floor. And everybody who wants to talk to one of the, to Jean-Michel, to Jan, or to Regina, may go there, have a cup of coffee, and talk about Erasmus and how to come to Oxford and whatever, and how to write a good bachelor and master thesis. They are really experts, both of them. Yeah.
Not me, but he can tell you about writing
good script.
So talk to him. So all the best, take care. Thank you.
Thank you.